What if I told you that using n8n, you can automate almost every aspect of managing or handling files in your life, be it fetching files from different systems, processing them, compressing them, decompressing them, or even uploading to your favorite cloud storage. Welcome to my course on AI automation powered by n8n. In the last lesson of this section 3 of this course, I'm going to talk about how to handle files in n8n so that you can automate your processes or workflows or any kind of AI automation which deals with files. And by the end of this lesson, you will be able to know how to work with binary data files in n8n or binary data in n8n, how to compress them, decompress them, and automate any file-based handling or management in your workflows. But before we go into the screen share, let's understand very quickly what is binary data in n8n. Well, binary data in n8n refers to any type of file. It could be a PDF file, image file, PNG, JPGs. It could be a video file as well. It could be a zip file, CSV file. Any type of file that you deal with in your day-to-day life can be managed with binary data in n8n. And this binary data appears in a binary view tab that is dedicatedly available in n8n for you to process files, where you can preview some of the files like images. You can directly preview in n8n. You can download those files and see the contents of it so that you can further process it while you are building your AI automation workflows. And finally, you can process the metadata as well, like file names, file extensions, what type of file it is, MIME types, and all that metadata is also available for the files in the binary view of n8n. So now let's get to the screen share and understand how you can work with files step by step. All right, I'm logged into the cloud instance of my n8n workspace, and you can see that I have created a new workflow called workflow 15, working with files. We are going to first start by adding a trigger. So let's add a manual trigger over here. Now, since we have to fetch the file should be available somewhere accessible to our n8n workspace. And for that, I'm going to go to my blog and download this beautiful picture of Manali Leh Highway, which is more like one of the adventurous roads out there in the world, in the Trans-Himalayas of India. And you can see I have this URL over here from my travel blog. I'm going to copy this. Now we'll go back to our workflow, and in order to fetch this particular image or download this image, we'll have to make an HTTP request. And we have already worked with HTTP request node in the past lessons of this course, so go and watch that lesson in order to know how HTTP request node works. But for now, you can follow along as well. So I'm going to click on this plus icon and search for HTTP request node. So this is the node. It makes an HTTP request and returns the response data. So we are going to use that. In the method, we are going to leave get because we have to fetch the image or download the image. There is no authentication required because it's a publicly available image out there on the internet. So I'm going to just paste the URL. You can leave the query parameters, headers, body, everything should be blank because you can access this file or the image publicly by just the URL itself. So I'm going to click on execute. And here our n8n node has fetched the image that we wanted to preview in our workflow over here. And you can see that this image is available in a new tab called binary tab over here. And there are two buttons. One is view button and one is download button. View button helps us with the preview of the file. So if I click on view button, it is going to access that file and show a preview inside our n8n workspace or the workflow builder that we have over here. It is just for preview purposes. If we go back to the list, you can click on download and it is going to download the file in my downloads folder. So this is how you can fetch the binary data, and this is where this binary tabs comes into play, where basically binary data or files data will be available in your n8n workflows. So far in the course, we were familiar with schema tab, table tab, and JSON tab, which generally fetches the text-based data or text-based input or output from the request that we make. But the file data would be available in the binary tab. The file that we requested has been returned in a field name called data, and the details of the file or metadata is also attached over here. You can see that file name is this, directory is this, file extension is this, MIME type is this, and the file size is also over here. So now there could be a scenario that I want to optimize or, you know, put some sort of image compression algorithm in place and want to automate that process in order to compress or optimize the size and the resolution of the images that are uploaded on my blog. So now I have access to it. I can further build the workflow on top of this binary data and process all the images on my blog so that they render faster on various devices according to the resolution that is requested by those devices, and my website or travel blog can load faster. 11.1 MB is still a significant size for an image data, but I'm not going to solve that problem here in this lesson. So let's get back to our lesson. So this is how a single file looks like. Now if we go back to our canvas, let's add a Gmail node to download all the email attachments which are coming in my Gmail inbox. Some sort of an email is coming. There are attachments to it. I want to download all those attachments, maybe upload it to Google Drive. You might have seen that lesson on my YouTube channel where I showed how to automatically save the files which are coming in your Gmail inbox to a Google Drive folder. Make them organized, make them structured. If you have not watched that video, you can go and check that video as well. But over here, let's continue with our lesson and add a Gmail tag. So over here, I'll add Gmail and we want to get a message. In fact, we'll say get many messages, because for get message, I would need the message ID, which I don't want. So I'll just limit it to one, and we are going to fetch from a GenAI Unplugged account. So I'm going to fetch this. And in my GenAI Unplugged email box, I have this email which has these 6 or probably 9 attachments over here. So let's fetch them out. All right, it has returned the data for that email. You can see the subject or snippet over here. Subject is unable to renew subscription, and that was the subject in my email as well. However, you notice that there is no binary tab over here. Although there were attachments in the email, but there is no binary tab over here. In order to do that, what you have to do is in this Gmail node, you have to turn off this simplify. This would enable this options over here. And in the add options, you have to select download attachments and then enable it. So this is now going to download all the attachments which are there for any particular email that you are trying to fetch from your Gmail inbox. Another option is to use attachment prefix. So you can see that attachment prefix is attachment underscore. I'm going to leave it blank for now, and I'm going to click on execute step. So here you can see all the 0 to 1, 2, 3, 4 till 8 attachments would be there. In total, 9 attachments or 9 files all have been returned in the binary tab of this particular node. And rest of the tabs which are there in this output, JSON, table, schema, it is all providing the textual data associated to that particular email. Now, if we go back to our canvas, let me execute the entire workflow so that both the nodes have executed. So one thing that you can see over here is earlier we fetched a single image from my travel blog, which was just one image, and one item was returned and nothing was returned in JSON because there was nothing there as a text data for the image. But over here with this Gmail node as well, you are seeing just one item. What about all the other attachments that we fetched? The output over here in the binary tab was showing us there are like 9 attachments, but still one item is being returned as an output to that node because only one single email has been returned. All these files are associated to the JSON data which is over here. So this is my email data. You can see that headers are there, HTML, text is there, body is there, to is there, from is there, all these details are mentioned. So all those attachments belonging to this email are downloaded as binary files, but they are all associated with this single email. That's why you are seeing a single email or single item being returned as an output of this Gmail node. So how do you access all those attachment files? You can use split out node over here. So this split out node provides this fields to split out configuration that is there, where we have to drag the field name, but all these attachments that you are seeing, they are coming in binary. So I'll just write $binary because that's where all these attachments are available under this field name. So this node is going to split this field name into multiple files. So you can see now it has returned 9 items at the top. All the attachments which you see over here have been returned as separate items from this particular node. And you notice that this particular file or attachment did not have a view button because n8n's workflow editor or canvas does not support the preview of PDF files, you can download it and then open it on your local machine. However, images are the ones where the preview button is available, not with the PDF documents. But that's how you are able to split these files, and now you can basically further process these files as they have been splitted out as 9 items. You can have any kind of processing on top of them. Maybe you want to process them in batches or loops using loop over nodes. You can do that. Maybe you want to have a switch case, and based on the MIME type or the file type, you want to process all these images or upload them in some sort of a structured way on a cloud storage. The choice will be completely yours, howsoever you want to process or handle or manage these files now. What if you want to compress files? Well, for that as well, there is a node which allows you to compress and decompress files. So I will attach that node to this Gmail node and search for compress. So you can see compression is available, but it compresses and decompresses files as well. Let's click on that, and you can select the action compress file or decompress file or multiple files. So I'll just say compress files. In this operation is compress, you can select decompress as well. So this is a field that expects the file name to be over here. And if you want to compress multiple files, you will have to specify the names of the files by a comma separated list. So in this example, I'm just going to copy paste the file names over here. So I'll just use this, and then we'll just separate out this. Maybe I only want these three attachments to be compressed. So I've used that. If you compare it with the split out node, which allowed us to just mention $binary and then split out all the files which were there as separate items. Ideally, I would expect n8n to modify this built-in compression node, decompression node as well, so that that can handle that process automatically along with this capability of comma separated list. But so far it does not support. So if I write $binary over here, it's not going to work out. I'll have to create some sort of a JavaScript expression to emit out a comma separated list out of it, and better way would be to use a code node before it in order to emit out that list and then use that variable over here if you want to have all the files. So in the output format, you can select zip or gzip. I will leave it to zip. We have to provide a file name over here, so I'll say gmail attachments dot zip. Next field is put output file in the field. So this is the field name. So for example, over here, the attachment underscore 4 is the field name. So this is expecting a label or a name from us where this node should output this Gmail underscore attachment dot zip. I will leave it as is and execute the step. So you can see it has compressed all three files in this Gmail attachments dot zip. Oops, I have some sort of a typo over here in Gmail, but that's okay. But you got the idea that file name is there, extension is there, MIME type is there, and file size is there. And this entire zip file is available under the field called data. If I download it, it will download to my downloads folder. And if I open it up, it's going to extract that. And if I open this, you can see that all the three files that we had specified as comma separated list are available as downloaded files on my local machine. Now we go back. Let's go back to the canvas. And similarly, we can perform a decompress operation as well. So let's add the same node again, and let's have decompress operation. Over here, it is asking us to decompress input binary files is data. Again, that's what basically the data field is. So I'll leave it blank. And then output prefix is file underscore. So let's execute this step, and it is going to decompress the file that is coming inside. This file was coming under this data field. We have specified the data field. Output prefix was file underscore. So you can see file underscore 0, file underscore 1, and file underscore 2. All those files which we compressed are now available. But again, you can see that these are available as a one item. So in order to access all these three items, we will have to basically again use a split out node. So if I use the split out node over here, and over here, you know that you can mention this $binary. So we'll write, and if I execute this step, it is going to emit out three items. So it has emitted out all three files that we just decompressed. You can basically download any zip file using the HTTP request node and then have the split out operation in order to split those files or decompress a file or zip file which is publicly available on the internet. And that's how you compress, decompress. Now that you have these three files, what about if you want to upload them to your favorite cloud storage? Maybe you have a Google Drive, maybe you have OneDrive, maybe you have SharePoint, maybe you have Amazon S3 bucket or Azure Blob storage. You can upload to any of your cloud storage provider by connecting the relevant node. And I'll show you an example of how you can upload it to Google Drive. So if I click on it, let's search for Drive. So you can see that we have Microsoft OneDrive, Google Drive, and Pipe Drive as well. So we'll upload the file to the or files to the Google Drive. So you can click on this and you can click on upload file. So this gives us the access to the configuration screen of Google Drive. Over here, it is asking for your credentials. So I already have an account or credentials associated to it. Resources file operation is upload, and input data field name over here is data. We'll have to write file_0. If you have to specify these names dynamically, I have shown that in the lesson or the video where I talked about how to upload multiple files on your Google Drive from your Gmail automatically. So go and watch that video, how to access the field name that is coming over here in the binary output of your previous node. I showed it with the examples of keys function, which can be made available if you write a JavaScript expression. So that way, this node is going to upload one by one all these files and would have the name of this input data field name dynamically populated. Similarly, here we can mention a file name as well. So I'll say test upload from _n8n. And if you have to access the properties over here or all the metadata, again, go and watch the same video where I talk about not just how to access keys dynamically, but the values within the keys as well, so that you can access these properties like file name, file extension as well. So now parent drive is my drive. And from list, it's root folder. I'm going to select something else. So I'm going to select mock data over here. So let's open the mock data. This is the mock data folder. Right now, this file does not exist. So I'm going to go ahead and select this. And now I'm going to execute this. So let's execute it. So this has errored out because first file was uploaded successfully because it had file_0. If we go back to our Google Drive, you would see test_upload from n8n. So this file has been successfully uploaded, but while it tried to access file_1, it did not find, because every node in n8n executes for each item being input. If I go to the settings and say execute once, and if I just delete this one, let's just delete this. Now that file no longer exists in my Google Drive. Now if I come back over here, go to parameters, execute it, it should be successful without any error, because now it is going to execute only for one item, which was file_0, and not going to iterate over other items because we changed the setting to execute once. So you can see that it has been successful. If I go to my Google Drive, you would see test_upload from n8n is uploaded successfully. But don't forget to watch that video where I explain how to handle this kind of data dynamically. I have provided the link in the description of the video as well. Now let's get back to our canvas and see what other nodes are available to you while dealing or handling files in n8n. So if I click on this plus icon and search for file, you would see that there are multiple nodes that are available. These are some, you know, file scan request, file maker, then compression we just saw in action. There is read and write files from disk. So read and write files from computer that runs n8n. If you are hosting n8n locally, then you can process the files which are available on your local disk locally. I'm using the n8n cloud version, so I cannot use or access my local data or local file system. However, if you are locally running the n8n instance, then you can access the files from the disk using this particular node. This is another node, convert to file, where you are getting the JSON data which is coming in our JSON tab. If you want to convert it into a binary file for some purpose, maybe you just want to log that data in file and upload that file onto a server or some sort of a storage. So you can use this to convert the JSON data into a file and then upload that file onto the cloud storage or wherever the storage you want to upload it to. Then extract from file, this converts the binary data to JSON. It's more like opposite of what this node does. Then you have a FTP as well. This allows you to leverage the FTP or SFTP protocol so that you can upload all download files from any sort of FTP server. So if I click on it, you can see delete file or folder, download a file, list folder content, rename or move file or folder, and upload file. All these actions or operations are supported by FTP node. So basically, you can develop a full-blown FTP client using n8n automation workflows. Now that you have mastered the concepts of file handling in your automation workflows, you can pretty much create any sort of file handling system, such as automated file processing pipelines, or even create automation syncs with your cloud storages. This marks the completion of entire section 3, where we talked about some of the advanced concepts which are available in n8n. In the section 4, we are going to talk about error management, error handling, debugging your workflows, and overall what are error workflows in n8n and how you can use them to make your workflows more reliable, more predictable when they are put in production. So stay tuned, and I'll see you in the next section 4 of this course.